Well, as you can see, tonight's topic is women in astronomy, shared by Ken Burton and Diane Hall. I almost feel like neither one of them needs an introduction. They're up here all the time, as you know. Diane is our delegate to the Great Lakes Association of Astronomy Clubs, and she holds the Office of Public Outreach, really into space shuttle stuff, and observing the sky since she was a young girl. And she co-hosts the weekly show Space Pirate Radio on Astronomy FM.
Yarr!
Ken's been a member of the Society since the late 1970s. He's held the office of Vice President and President. As you heard tonight, he often goes to solar eclipses and sometimes sees them. And he has been awarded by this club with the John Searles Award and the Lifetime Membership. So I'll let them sort out who goes first and second, but you're on.
Okay, I'm going to be riding the unicycle and she's going to be...
I will pay money.
There'll be two funerals. All right, tonight Diane and I are going to be discussing four of the great luminaries of astronomy who happen to be ladies. And I will be discussing Caroline Herschel and Cecilia Payne, and she will be handling Henrietta Leavitt and Annie Jump Kemp. And since Herschel came first, she was a member of the very, very well-known astronomy family. And the Herschel family included her brother, Sir William, the discoverer of Uranus and a couple of moons, and her nephew, William's son, Sir John, who was the first to really to actually make studies of the southern skies. Both of them were very, very well-known and revered, as was Caroline, as you'll see, in a time when women were not. Caroline Herschel was born in 1750 in Hanover, Germany, March 16, 1750, and was ultimately one of 10 children. At the age of 10, she was struck with typhus, which subsequently stunted her growth. She never grew taller than 4'3" and remained frail throughout her life. Her father once told her she would never marry because of her looks and because she was not rich. In addition, primarily because of the times, her mother resisted giving her an education, saying that it was Caroline's duty to take care of her brothers. Despite all of this, Caroline's father secretly educated her, and she ultimately displayed musical talent as well as a gift for mathematics. Music was an important part of life for the Herschel family. Caroline's father was in the military museum, and her older brothers, William and Alexander, as well as Caroline, showed exceptional talent. In 1767, Isaac, her father, died, and Caroline was relegated to help her mother with the daily work in the house. The thought to have no other duties than to wash, bleach, and iron the tablecloth worried her. And that is, of course, she was happy when her older brother, Wilhelm, or William, asked her to come to England for an education as a singer. In the summer of 1772, Wilhelm came to Hanover to help his sister with the travel to Bath. She would see Hanover again 50 years later. In Bath, Wilhelm started to train her as a singer, but also taught Caroline in the English language and in mathematics. Despite her frailty, she was a soprano and gave many successful performances, among which were solo parts in The Messiah and Judas Maccabeus. This was the home that they shared in Bath.
Ken, is that home, that's still there?
Yes, it is. It is still there, yes. During breaks in the evening, they talked about the stars. In 1774, being dissatisfied with telescopes then available, William began making telescopes to observe the sky. Caroline became his apprentice. Most of her astronomical work was helping William by writing down his observations, but besides that work, Caroline was observing on her own, notably with the 27-inch focal-length Newtonian sweeper. This is actually that scope. William once commented that Caroline had a way with numbers, and he felt comfortable letting Caroline finalize the observations during the day. She also planned each night's observing schedule. Knew too little about of the real heavens to be able to point out every object so as to find it, again, without losing too much time by consulting the atlas. Quote, but all those troubles were removed when I knew my brother to be a great distance-making of the observations with various instruments on double stars, planets, etc. And I could have his assistance immediately when I found a nebula or cluster of stars, of which I intended to give a catalog. But at the end of 1783, I had only marked 14 when my sweeping was interrupted by being employed to write down my brother's observations with the 20-foot. And here's the 20-foot. After William discovered Uranus in 1781, things began to change for the Herschels. In 1782, William was appointed court astronomer to the King George III and granted an annual royal pension of £200. Occasions came up when William would have to leave town on business and Caroline began spending more and more time at the telescope. Prior to the completion of the 18.7-inch reflector, she would use the small Newtonian sweeper to do her studies. She found her first object in 1783 on February 26, which turned out to be the open cluster that is known today as NGC 2360. Her second object was found in August of 1783 and is a galaxy with the modern designation of NGC 205. It had also been noted by Messier back in 1773, but was not then a part of his famous list of objects. It was later designated M110. Caroline found her third object on September 23rd, 1783, and it is the galaxy which is known today as NGC 253. Caroline found other objects in 1783. They were later designated as NGC 381, 659, 2548, which is M48, NGC 6633, and 7789. 1784, she found NGC 225, and in 1787, she found NGC 2380. Another object found in 1783 was later designated as NGC 2349, but seemed to be non-existent. Here are photos of each of those discoveries. It should be noted here that the work of Caroline and her brother William actually ended Charles Messier's pursuit of additional objects for his catalog. He pretty much said that what's the point in adding to this tiny list while the Herschels have cataloged a couple of thousand such objects. Two moves came in the next few years. First, William moved the observatory to Old Windsor to be closer to the king. And then he moved to Slough, just a short distance from Old Windsor. This actually is the place of the birth of John. Caroline's biggest break came in Slough, when on August 1st, 1786, she found a comet moving slowly through Leo. William was in Germany at the time. Caroline Herschel was the first woman to discover a comet. That was Comet 1786, which discovered six more. Also discovered numerous objects, again, such as M110. Caroline suspected that this was a comet and observed it again on August the 2nd. She confirmed that it had moved, thus proving it was a comet. She wrote letters to various other astronomers announcing her discovery, and it was soon observed by astronomers throughout Europe. Although everyone was aware of Caroline's ability as an observer for some time, the world would now become aware as well. 1787, King George III gave Caroline a £50 per year salary to continue as William's assistant, and she became the first woman officially recognized for a scientific position. When William was married in 1788, there was a strained relationship between Caroline and William's new spouse, which caused Caroline to move to her own place. However, although Caroline continued to work as his assistant, she was doing more independent work. She discovered her second comet in 1788, December 21st, which ended up being followed by astronomers until February the 5th. Later computations revealed the comet moved in a rather long period orbit, but the exact period was uncertain because of the shorter observation interval. Interestingly, a comet found by Roger Rigolet, who lived from 1909 to 1981, he discovered it in 1939 and was found to be identical to the Herschel's 1788 comet. It is now known as periodic comet Herschel-Rigolet and returns every 155 years. Caroline found additional comets January of 1790, April 18th, 91, December 15th, 93, October of 1995, and November of 1797, and also one of August 14th. Besides discovering comets, Caroline was also involved in other astronomy pursuits. She became recataloging John Flamsteed's star catalog, submitted to the Royal Society in 1798, together with an additional 560 stars, which Flamsteed had omitted. Caroline continued updating Flamsteed's catalog. She continued her observing work and cataloged every discovery that she and William made. On the death of William in 1822, she returned to Hanover and continued a work on the catalog. She mentored nephew John, bringing advice and support to his work. She sent the completed catalog to the Royal Astronomical Society and was awarded the gold medal in 1828 and was proclaimed an honorary member of the Royal Astronomical Society in 1835, the first woman to be as such named. 1838, she was elected to the Royal Irish Academy and awarded the Gold Medal of Science by the King of Prussia in 1846. To be seen with her in public was an honor, and she was received with distinction by the Prussian aristocracy. She had many friends and was a strong influence, again, on nephew John, having many discussions with the prominent British astronomer. Caroline lived to see the discovery of Neptune, in that she lived at the age of 98. Caroline Creasia Herschel died January the 9th, 1848, and was buried at the Gardenland Cemetery Church of her childhood Hanover, Germany. And here it says on the tombstone, here rests the earthly veil of Caroline Herschel. Born in Hanover, March the 16th, 1750, the eyes of her who passed glory, while below turned to the starry heavens, her own discoveries of the comets, her share in the immortal labors of her brother William Herschel, bear witness of this to later ages. The Royal Academy of Dublin, the Royal Astronomical Society of London, numbered her among their members. At the age of 97 years, 10 months, she fell asleep in happy peace and in full possession of her faculties, following to a better life her father, Isaac Herschel, who lived to the age of 16 years, 7 months, and lies near this spot since March the 25th, 1767. Merely Herschel was honored by the astronomical community by naming the lunar crater after him. see Herschel. In 1889, asteroid 281, Lucretia was named to honor Caroline Lucretia Herschel. It had been discovered on October 31st, 1888 by J. Palisa of Vienna. And that's the story of Caroline Herschel. And we now move to part two and part three. And I present it to you, our juggler.
All right. Y'all hear me all right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So with this, we move from the age of the gentleman, scientist, and royal patronage to the new world, universities, research assistants, photographs, and modern science. Henrietta Leavitt. Born in 1868, died in 1921, not a particularly long life, and as we're going to learn, not a particularly well-documented one. So, she's something of a puzzle, and she may remain so because she left very few letters. She left no journal. We know almost nothing of her inner life, her feelings toward her work, her feelings toward fellow astronomers. Really, she died too soon, and that I mean both she died fairly young, and in terms of our society, if she had lived another 10 years, like her co-worker Annie Jump Cannon, who survived her by 2 decades, she might have found a more public, more appreciated niche in society. But as it is, we don't have a wealth of information about her either as a scientist or as a human being. We do know she was a minister's daughter, born on the 4th of July in Massachusetts, from old Puritan stock, I think you can trace back for several centuries. Several of her male relatives were named for Erasmus Darwin, the grandfather of Charles. Erasmus II, her uncle, was the second president of the American Society of Mechanical Engineers, a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and had the nickname the Steam Engine Titan. I couldn't find any pictures of him, but one of his engines is well preserved today at Chestnut Hill Station at the Boston Waterworks. And Chuck, I do expect you to check it out for me. So this was not an unremarkable family. Not like the Herschels, perhaps, but not, she didn't just spring into existence from people who didn't have some kind of place in society, which is typical of the women who went to college in this era. And she did go to college. Her family valued education. They relocated, and this seems funny in our era, from Cambridge, Massachusetts to Cleveland. And Henrietta enrolled in Oberlin College, which would have looked about like that. She was there some years before 1909, but that's close enough. One of her cousins, the daughter of Uncle Erasmus, also went to Oberlin College. So this was a family that believed in educating their daughters. After 2 years, she went back east. She transferred to Radcliffe, where she took her first astronomy class. And this was in her fourth year of university. She earned an A-. The certificate that she earned at Radcliffe would have been the equivalent of a Bachelor's of Arts at Harvard, which did not admit any women at that time. Instead, she gets the Radcliffe certificate and has to be satisfied with that. We do know that prior to studying astronomy, she studied music. But as a young woman, she began to lose her hearing. So, as with Annie Jump Cannon, of whom we'll hear more, she focused her interests elsewhere.
Sorry.
So,
You skipped one.
Oh, sorry. There we go. Okay, so when she was in that final year of Radcliffe, she did some volunteer work at Harvard Observatory in what was called the Stellar Photometry Department. She left for a two-year tour of Europe in 1896. We don't know where she went. We don't know what she did. We assume she enjoyed herself. And then she came back and she worked for a while at a liberal arts college as an art teacher. This apparently was not satisfying to her, so in 1902, she wrote to the director of the Harvard Observatory, a man named Edward Pickering, and asked if he might recommend her an observatory in a more comfortable climate. He had no suggestions for that, but he did like Leavitt. He had appreciated her work when she was a volunteer assistant, And so he offered her a full-time job as a computer, which of course does not mean anything to do with silicon chips, but meant that this was somebody doing computation. Pickering liked having women. He felt that they were diligent, he felt that they were trustworthy, he felt that they were amateurs, he felt that they were not scientists, he felt that he was not paying them to think. And to be honest, he didn't really pay them all that much. They made about 25 cents an hour, which for a factory worker was pretty good for a pink-collar job of the era where you were, you know, being a stenographer or a secretary. It wasn't that great. He must have liked Henrietta because he gave her 30 cents an hour instead of the regular 25. Now, Pickering sounds like a bit of a jerk. He was, in some respects, quite a bit better than many men of his era. His first hire in his observatory was his former housekeeper, who was a very clever woman named Williamina Fleming, and she became, from his housekeeper, curator of astronomical photographs by the time she died in 1911. So he may not have been a perfect boss, but he wasn't bad. But he did frustrate the women who worked for him. So among the women, or girls, of Pickering's observatory was Annie Jump Cannon, senior with Henrietta in 1913, about 10 years after Henrietta joined the team. Cannon's journal entries provide one of the best glimpses we have of Leavitt. They demonstrate the affection that Cannon and the other astronomers felt for her. They were similar in some ways. They were diligent workers. They didn't give Pickering a lot of grief, which Fleming did at times. Antonio Mori, another worker there, did. They were unmarried. They were well-educated. They were childless. Though Cannon was quite a maternal figure, bubbly, gregarious. Leavitt was said by a male co-worker in her obituary to have a nature full of sunshine. She was also known for being dutiful, serious-minded, a little bit stern, kind of your stereotypical Puritan traits, your stereotypical spinster traits. One comment was she approached her work with an almost religious zeal. Got some of these old maid stereotypes at work here in the way people perceived her. Now what was she doing? Well, she was looking for variable stars in a cache of photographic plates taken by the Harvard employees down in Peru of the Large and Small Magellanic Clouds. She used an instrument called a blink comparator that would flip forth back and quickly between two images. And if you were looking for an asteroid or later Pluto, which was found through this process, you would see something move. The variable star would show up as a flashing spot. And using this method, she discovered 2,400 variable stars. How's that, Gary? A feat that did not go unnoticed by other astronomers. One of Pickering's colleagues from Princeton wrote to him congratulating him on his variable star fiend of a computer. And actually she got into the Washington Post that wrote up a little tongue-in-cheek thing comparing her to her star discoveries to a guy named Frohman, who discovered like theater starlets and things like that. So she made a bit of a splash with her progress. And she discovered something. Now remember, Pickering was paying her to find the stars. He wasn't paying her that 30 cents an hour to think about them, but she did. And she noticed that there was a relationship between the apparent brightness of some of these variable stars and the length of their period between, you know, maximum brightness and, you know, minimal brightness. And she thought that if you could work out this relationship, you might be able to determine important things about these stars. So she picked 25 of them in the Small Magellanic Cloud, which are all approximately the same distance from Earth, so the apparent magnitude isn't completely misleading. They should all have the same distance relative to one another, so a base magnitude should actually determine how luminous the star is. And she worked out the graph. And this nice little demure phrase, it is worthy of notice that the brighter variables have longer periods. People noticed. One of the guys who noticed this publication, which came in 1912, was a guy called Harlow Shapley. And he took that data and he used it to calculate the distance of one of these particular kind of variable stars. They're called Cepheid variables. And in 1915, he worked out the distance to a star that was not among these 25. He was able to plop it right where it needed to be on the curve of Leavitt's graph. And suddenly, you have this tool for measuring the universe that nobody had really anticipated. If you can find these Cepheid variables in constellations, ultimately in other galaxies, you can figure out from the rate at which they are pulsing how far away, how bright they truly are. You can figure out how far away they are, and you've got something to measure, you know, beyond the reach of parallax, which has its limitations in how far you can go out before it's not useful anymore. Is it perfect? No, actually it was a pretty crude tool. There were a lot of things about variable stars that people did not understand then, and the original estimates in terms of math were wrong. They just were. But they were onto something. So Einar Hertzsprung, Edwin Hubble, Shapley, they all made use of this crude, but very powerful tool to begin to understand both the age and the size of the universe. So this was like Nobel Prize material, right? Well, no. I like this picture because just the actual terrible, terrible quality of it illustrates how difficult it is to find anything on Leavitt. Her career at the observatory was interrupted by illnesses, by family events. Her father died, relatives got sick, she got sick, she had to go to the family farm in Wisconsin to recuperate. And this did not put her in Pickering's bad graces. He valued her. But she wasn't doing science at the rate that she might have been doing science under ideal circumstances. And she even credited her astronomy work with impacting her hearing, which may not have been the case in terms of modern medicine, but hey, that's what they thought back then. She may also have been a bit of a victim of her own diligence and that New England Puritan work ethic. So some of the computers, particularly Antonio Maury, they did some sloppy work. Maury was the niece of Henry Draper, who was a big guy in science, and she had owed her job to that, and she wanted to be known as a famous scientist, but perhaps didn't do the best job with the numbers. Leavitt turned in quality work despite all of her absences, and so she got difficult tasks that needed precision, but maybe weren't the best use of her time and her mind. Did she complain? Of course not. Though I did find an interesting feminist book on science that pointed out that of Pickering's girls, here all posing as paper dolls, Leavitt was one of them who wanted the right to be able to theorize for herself and not just be a number machine. So Pickering took her off the Magellanic Cloud Dead and put her on something called the North Polar Sequence. This is one of these things that mattered very much to him. It involved 96 stars, all within 10 degrees of the North Pole, that Pickering wanted to be used as an international standard for stellar magnitude and color. So again, important, at least as he saw it. Best use of Leavitt's time? Probably not. But she went and she did it. She spent years on it, even when she was not feeling well, and published in 1917. Then Pickering died the following year. And the girls at Pickering's office got a new boss. Mr. Harlow Shapley. Levitt may have hoped, again, we don't know, she didn't leave in any revealing information, but she exchanged letters with Shapley. He was respectful and enthusiastic. He valued her work on the variables. At this point, he used them to determine the relative distances of globular clusters, and he now had a new, improved estimate of the size of the Milky Way. He would later call her one of the most important women to touch astronomy, but given enough he did touch astronomy, we don't know what that really meant in his head. He also was the kind of guy who measured how difficult it was to do the computational task by using girl hours and kilo girl hours. And as you can see from the picture, some of these girls were in their mid-50s, so, you know, it was a different era. Well, we don't know how this relationship would have worked out. We know that by this point, because we have U.S. Census data from 1920, Levitt called herself an astronomer. She thought of herself as an astronomer, not as a computer, not as a girl, worker, clerk. But unfortunately, she was again ill, this time with a malignant stomach trouble, in other words, cancer. Shapley visited her, and Cannon came to visit, but she died on December 12th of 1921. She was buried in her family's plot at the same cemetery where Henry James, William James, and other Boston luminaries were buried, left behind an estate worth about $300. The photometric study of the southern sky that included her variable star research, the North Polar Sequence data, and a program of photographic measures of variable stars that she really just started. Her desk at Harvard Observatory was given to a woman called Cecilia Payne, of whom you'll hear more this evening. And Payne in particular came to believe that Levitt had been done a very great wrong by Pickering, that by spending her time on those North Polar Sequence stars, just measuring color and magnitude, a brilliant scientist had been condemned to work that left not only her own interests unsatisfied, but set back the study of variable stars for decades. 4 months after Levitt's funeral, Annie Jump Cannon went down to Peru, and she did note in her diary, "Magellanic cloud, great, so bright. It always makes me think of poor Henrietta, how she loved the clouds." There is an ironic postscript to Levitt's life. 1925, Harvard Observatory received a letter from an elderly Swedish mathematician who learned for work from a colleague and decided to write to honor Miss Levitt, who by this point had been dead for 4 years, discussed the possibility of nominating her for Nobel Prize, asked for more information on her work, dropped some hints she might want to be his protege. Shapley answered the letter in a subtly condescending manner that indicated that he, and not the late Miss Levitt, deserved the Nobel Prize for the breakthrough on the set of variables.
Oh, jeez.
And of course, Nobel Prizes are not awarded to deceased. Levitt did get a crater named for her on the far side of the moon, as part of an effort to recognize the scientific contributions of the deaf. Her other contributions were made pretty much obscure. The North Polar Sequence data was only used as an international standard until 1950. And even then, it was really thought of as Pickering's thing, not Miss Levitt's. She didn't really get a proper biography until 2005, and even then author George Johnson was just stymied at how little he could find on her. So that was a bit of a sad story. This is the happy part. This is a much happier story. Annie Jump Cannon, seen some pictures of her already, read a few of her quotes. She was born December 11th, 1863, to a state senator from Delaware named Wilson, and his second wife, Mary Jump Cannon. Prosperous family, Annie was joined by a couple of sisters, but was stricken by scarlet fever, which robbed her of her hearing, so she, like Levitt, was ultimately deaf. Now, some historians have claimed that deafness caused her social difficulties so that she then propelled herself into work. That really doesn't seem to make sense in terms of everything else we know about her. She was far more gregarious than Henrietta. Her interests in life included music. She played the piano, so it's not that like losing her hearing just caused her to focus everything on astronomy, and she seems to have had some degree of hearing aid to the end. So it's a little bit of romance that doesn't seem to be correct. Cannon was taught the constellations by her mother as a child, and she went as an undergraduate to the newly opened Wellesley College, studying astronomy and physics and spectroscopic measurements. She was mentored there by Sarah Whiting, the director of the physics lab, and became a photography enthusiast and quite a skilled photographer. She graduated in 1884 and then left on a tour of Europe, taking photos with a box camera, which she turned into a photographic essay called In the Footsteps of Columbus, that was then offered as a souvenir to people at the Chicago World's Fair in 1893. And you can now download this and have an annotated version of her essay if you are into such things, which is pretty neat. You would think that this would be a pretty satisfying life, but it wasn't. By the time she was 30, she was bored. She was dissatisfied. She lamented her lack of accomplishments in her journal. She wanted more money. And when her mother died in 1894, she went back to Wellesley and became an assistant in the physics department. You can see her here observing with her 4-inch telescope. She then, like Henrietta Leavitt had done, migrated to Radcliffe and began to study astronomy, took part in early X-ray experiments, and began working for Mr. Pickering in his observatory full of girls. She did ultimately get a Master's of Art from Wellesley in 1907, but of course, the world remembers her for other things. Yeah. Okay. So she had kept up with the spectroscopy. She could classify up to 3 stars a minute by looking at their spectral patterns, which is the fingerprint of a star, indicating temperature, mass, chemical makeup, diameter. The element helium was initially discovered as a yellow line in the spectrum of our sun during a solar eclipse. So she was working with hydrogen and helium absorption lines, the dark lines in a colorful spectrum. Working at a time when modern atomic theory was not yet developed and people really didn't know the full meaning of these lines, but they were trying, and she inherited a classification system from Wilhelmina Fleming, that former housekeeper of Pickering's, who was now in charge of the department where Cannon worked. Stars with the deep hydrogen lines were class A, the next deepest were class P, B, and it went all the way down to P. And so this was a cumbersome system, and Cannon ended up turning it around. Now, she was not a theorist. This may have allowed her to be happy working for Pickering. Payne later said of her, she was a pure observer, she did not interpret. Cannon's been compared to a person with a phenomenal memory for faces. She looked at a star, she knew it. She looked at it again even years later, she recognized it. And it is said that when she really wanted to tune out the world and just do her thing, she would turn off the hearing aid and let nobody bother. When Wilhelmina Fleming died in 1911, Cannon became a curator of astronomical photographs, and between then and 1915, she classified about 5,000 stars per month. She had a system. She wasn't doing it completely by herself, so she would examine the plate, call out the alphabetic designation for each spectrum to an assistant. The assistant wrote it down, and repeat, repeat, repeat. As I said, she recognized stars even years later. If somebody questioned her data, she could duplicate it many years after the fact. So she might not have been theorizing, but what she was doing, she was really good. And ultimately, she published a revised version of Fleming's classification in 1924. This is the "Oh, be a fine girl, kiss me" mnemonic, which some sources claim with. I don't believe it, but I can't prove that she didn't. Basic breakdown is you've got the hot blue stars type O, then going down through white light. The cooler sunlight stars are about, when the sun's about 5,700 Kelvin for its surface temperature, class G. then the very cool stars, class M, are red, and since then, stars below class M, even cooler, even redder, have been classified. This relates to the lines in the spectrum. The blue stars, the white stars, predominantly hydrogen, some different kinds of helium, and then when you get down to the white stars through the yellow ones, you start seeing metals, particularly in sunlight stars, you see ionized calcium in their spectra, and then the hydrogen disappears entirely, and the cooler stars contain only metals, no hydrogen, no helium. There are other factors in a star's designation. This one might be a little harder to read, but the luminosity classes. And then another layer of classifications has been added since then called the peculiar code, which indicates maybe there's nebular features, or maybe it seems like there's two stars in the spectrum. The sun's full classification is G2V. G for being yellow, white, five, not V. Five for being a class five being sequence star. So that's a good thing for us. We really wouldn't want to be around a 1A supergiant or a white dwarf. And as a not glamorous as this work seems, Cannon got a lot of acclaim in her lifetime for it, for a couple of different factors, one of which being she wrote books and wrote articles. She never did win the Nobel Prize, but in 1931 she became the first woman to win the Henry Draper Gold Medal from the National Academy of Sciences. And Harlow Shapley, previous winner, presented her the award with the following speech. He called her the benign presence of the brick building, noted collector of degrees and medals, author of 9 immortal volumes and several thousand oatmeal cookies, Virginia Reeler, bridge player, and especially the recipient of the Draper Medal. Note that he the first woman recipient, gets her cookie credentials. But the accolades just went on. Oxford University made her the first female recipient of an honorary doctorate. 5 other universities followed suit. American Association of Aerial Star Observers gave her the Nova Medal in 1922. 1923, League of Women Voters cited her as one of the 12 greatest female Americans living. 1933, she went to the World's Fair in the company of Amelia Earhart and Jane Addams to represent professional women. Part of her appeal may have been that she did present herself in a feminine manner, citing her femininity, her delicacy, her as being the kind of traits that she needed to do the work that she did as a scientist. It's an interesting way of looking at it that perhaps the aggression of Maury, of Fleming, even of Levitt might have kept them down in terms of their careers, whereas Cannon was able to play the game. But, you know, why fault if she did a magnificent job? She did not get to be a member of the National Academy of Sciences, as supposedly her deafness upset somebody, and they didn't want somebody like that on the NAS. She officially retired in 1940, but she kept working. In 1941, she wrote to a classmate from Wellesley that she was going to embark on a new project for Yale. "It will be a job," she wrote, "and of course I love to do it." Sadly, she died about 3 months later, at the age of 77. Though 1941 was already a completely different world from the one that Henrietta Leavitt left behind 2 decades earlier, we now knew that spiral nebulae were island universes, the V2 rocket engine, and atomic bombs were right on the horizon. Leavitt, I think, died before a time in which she could have been fully appreciated. Cannon got that. I think by anyone's measure, she lived a full, satisfying, deeply meaningful life doing what she loved. And thankfully, the world was able to give her something back for all that. She has a crater named in her honor, Cannon Crater, on the east northeast limb of the moon's near side. There was also an asteroid named for her, 1120 Cannonia, discovered in 1928. And down here on Earth, the American Astronomical Society gives the Annie Jump Cannon Award for outstanding research and promise for future research by a postdoctoral lunar researcher. This is the current recipient, so it's still being awarded very proudly. The original recipient back in 1934, Cecilia Payne. And with that, Ken, it's all yours.
Part four. Cecilia Helena Payne Kabashkin. Cecilia Payne was born on May 10, 1900, in Wendover, England, in the suburb of London. She was one of three children to Emma Lenora Helena Pelt Pertz and Edward John Payne. Her father was a London attorney, historian, and musician. This is Wendover. It is a suburb of London, as you can see. Her mother was born to a Prussian family, and in her own right had two very well-known uncles. George Heinrich Pertz was a renowned historian, and James John Garth Wilkeson, he was a Emanuel Swedenborg-inspired writer. So she came to some fame very early on. At only 4 years old, Edward Payne passed away, leaving Cecilia's mother the responsibility of raising three children on her own. She attended St. Paul's Girls' School as a child. This was a school whose musical director was Gustav Holst, the composer of The Planets, by the way. And because of exceptional performance, she received a scholarship to Newnham College at the Cambridge University. Although she studied botany, physics, and chemistry, it was a lecture by this astronomer Arthur Eddington, which he attended that sparked her interest in astronomy. The lecture detailed Eddington's 1919 expedition to the island of Principe in the Gulf of Guinea off the coast of Africa, where he observed and photographed the stars near a solar eclipse to test Einstein's general theory of relativity. Although she completed her studies, she was not awarded a degree because of her sex. Cambridge did not issue degrees to women until 1948. There was not a whole lot of options for women as to careers, and she realized that her future was in teaching, but she wasn't to be held down and actively started to seek grants so that she could enable herself to move to the United States. She was fortunate to meet Harlow Shapley, who we heard about before, the then director of the Harvard College Observatory. Shapley was a participant in the great debate with Heber Curtis on the nature of nebula and the size of the universe. Shapley had just formed a graduate program in astronomy. She emigrated to the United States in 1923, and Shapley also had developed the fellowship to encourage women to study at the Harvard Observatory. Cecilia Payne was the second student on the fellowship, first being Adelaide Ames, another noted astronomer who co-authored the Shapley Ames catalog. Under the tutelage of Shapley, Cecilia was convinced to write a doctoral dissertation. In 1925, she became the first person to earn a PhD in astronomy from Radcliffe College. Her thesis was Stellar Atmospheres, a contribution to the observational study of high temperature in the reversing layers of stars. Otto Struve called it undoubtedly the most brilliant PhD thesis ever written in astronomy. In it, Payne accurately was able to relate the spectral classes of stars to their actual temperatures by applying the ionization theory developed by the Indian physicist Meghna Saha. She showed that the great variations in stellar absorption lines was due to differing amounts of ionization at different temperatures, not too different, amounts of elements. She also found that silicon, carbon, and other metals seen in the sun spectra were present in about the same relative amounts as on Earth, in agreement with the accepted belief, in disagreement with the accepted belief at the time, which held that the stars had approximately the same elementary composition as the Earth. However, she found that helium, and particularly hydrogen, were vastly more abundant, open for hydrogen by a factor of about 1 million. Thus, her thesis established that hydrogen was the overwhelming constituent of the stars and accordingly was the most abundant element in the universe. Henry Norris Russell, the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram, reviewed her dissertation and convinced her to not present her conclusion that the sun was predominantly hydrogen since it contradicted the accepted beliefs at the time. After further study, Russell reconsidered for years later when he derived the same result by different means. He published his findings, acknowledging her work, but is still often given credit for the discovery even after Payne had been proven correct. In 1931, Cecilia Payne became an American citizen. 1933, while touring Europe, she met Russian-born astrophysicist Sergei A. Gaposchkin. After helping him to get a visa to the United States, they were married in the March of 1934. They set up house in Lexington, Massachusetts, a short commute from Harvard. They had three children, Edward, Catherine, and Peter. Catherine remembers her mother as an inspired seamstress, inventive knitter, and a voracious reader. Although an agnostic, she and her family were members of the First Unitarian Church, and she taught Sunday school there. Her younger brother, Humphrey, became director of the British School of Archaeology at Athens. Postdoctorate, Payne focused on the study of stars of high luminosity with the goal of understanding the structure of the Milky Way. After that, she surveyed all the stars brighter than the 10th magnitude, followed by a study of variable stars. By the way, you were talking about 30 observations. Well, she made over 1,250,000 observations with her assistants. She then extended this work to the Magellanic Clouds, adding a further 2 million observations of variable stars. Where did she have the time? This data was used by her to determine the paths of stellar evolution. Sharing the work with her husband on the study of variable stars laid the basis for all subsequent work on them. She spent her entire academic career at Harvard and remained scientifically active for the remainder of her life. She was the technical assistant to Shapley from 1927 to 1938, given no official position. At one point, she considered leaving Harvard because of her low status and poor salary. Shapley improved her position in fear of losing her and gave her the title of astronomer. That title was changed by her at request to Phillips astronomer. In 1943, she was elected to the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. It wasn't until 1945 that the courses that she taught at Harvard were recorded in the catalog. When Donald Menzel, one of the first theoretical astrophysicists in the US who discovered the physical properties of the solar chromosphere, became director at the Harvard College Observatory in 1954, and he worked to improve her appointment. In 1956, she was named the first woman to be promoted to full professor from within the faculty at Harvard's Faculty of Arts and Sciences. Later, she was appointed to the chair of the Department of Astronomy and thus became the first woman to head a department at Harvard. Celia had many students who made important contributions to astronomy. These include Helen Sawyer Hogg, noted for pioneering research into globular clusters of variable stars, Joseph Ashbrook, editor-in-chief of the Sky and Telescope magazine from 1964 till his death in 1980, Frank Drake, the founder of SETI, and Paul W. Hodge. His research into Barnard's galaxy resulted in his 1977 paper wherein he identified 16 star-forming H2 regions, which have been designated Hodge 1 to Hodge 16, and editor of the Astronomical Journal from 1984 to 2004. In 1966, she retired from active teaching and was appointed that year as Professor Emeritus of Harvard and continued as a member of the staff at the Smithsonian Astrophysical Observatory. Cynthia Payne Kapushkin's career was the turning point at Harvard College Observatory. Under the leadership of Shapley and Dr. E.J. Sheridan, whom Cecilia, hello, did you notice that there? I couldn't find a picture of him. It would have to be. Whom Cecilia described as a mentor.
Isn't that Arthur Eddington?
What's that? Sorry?
Isn't that Arthur Eddington?
That's E.J. Sheridan. There he is.
You see? Oh, that's Gary.
Of course it's Gary.
Hey, come on. Come on. He had it going, and then you open your big mouth.
As if you wouldn't have noticed that.
No, I don't know.
But you wouldn't have noticed it. Gary would have noticed it. All right. Okay. She determined that E.J. Sheridan was her mentor, and the observatory offered more opportunities in astronomy to women than did all other institutions. Although the institution was well populated by women with significant achievements, including Wilhelmina Fleming and Tony Morey, Annie Jump Cannon, and Henrietta Swan Leavitt, it was the PhD awarded to Cecilia that allowed women to enter the mainstream of astronomical discovery. Noted astrophysicist Joan Feynman, the younger sister of noted physicist Nobel laureate Richard Feynman, 1918-1988, contributes her entry into astronomy and astrophysics directly to Cecilia Payne Kapushkin, even after both her mother and grandmother tried to convince her that women weren't suited for, were capable of understanding scientific concepts. She made very important contributions to the study of solar wind particles in fields, sun and earth relations, and magnetospheric physics. She is also known for developing an understanding of the origin of auroras and creating a model that predicts the number of high-energy particles likely to hit a spacecraft over its lifetime, and also uncovering a method of predicting sunspot cycles. Cecilia Payne Kapushkin died 7 December 1979 at the age of 79 in Cambridge, Massachusetts. The cause of her death was not specified. Listed here are the academic books she authored, including an autobiography, which some of us is taking. The honors and awards, she was elected to the Royal Astronomy and Astronomical Society while still a student at Cambridge in 1923. She got the Annie Janet J. Cannon Award in Astronomy in 1934. She was the first recipient. Member of the American Philosophical Society in 1936. Member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences in 1943. Emeritus Professor at Harvard University in 1967. Henry Norris Russian Leadership of the American Astronomy Society in 1976. Award of Merit from Merit College in 1952. Written as Medal from the Rittenhouse Astronomical Society at Franklin Institute in 1961. Honorees from Rutgers, Wilson, Smith, Western, Colby, and Women's Medical College in Pennsylvania. And an asteroid 2039 Payne Kapushkin was named after her. It's fine. Astronomy students don't need to memorize my name. I only started the field. The reward of the young scientist is the emotional thrill of being the first person in the history of the world to see something or to understand something. Nothing can compare with that experience. The reward of the old scientist is the sense of having seen a vague sketch grow into a masterly landscape. Cecilia Payne Kapushkin accepting the Henry Norris Russell Prize from the American Astronomical Society. And that is the story of our women. It is 9:59. How's that? Obviously, the four premier ones, I would say, I guess you would agree.
Well, we thought about covering Fleming and Maury in depth, but really, in terms of a narrative, from Levin to Candy to Payne, I think kind of tells the story of women finally making the breakthrough.
Isn't it significant that, the four women you have here, that three of them are essentially American products? Now, hypothesis, that they could come up in this society as opposed to Europe with a more stratified class structure.
I think Levitt and Payne being, Levitt and Cannon being daughters of the upper middle class totally relevant, yes.
All right, that's true. But I have a tough time imagining any woman doing as much, Herschel aside, achieving as much in Central or Eastern Europe. And I've always got the Curie example, which maybe knocks me for six. I don't know.
Actually, it was the thesis of the feminist writer that I was reading that Curie is kind of a bad example for women in science because, like Einstein, at this point she's up on this exceptional pedestal and everybody else is pretty much obliterated. With regard to it being an American phenomenon, I think that a lot of factors came together, both women moving into the workforce, America becoming the epicenter of academic astronomy research, and the position of women going into formal education at places like Wellesley, which I think had only been open for 5 years when Cannon went there, and Radcliffe. It just all came together in the right time, and you had a guy like Hickory who, whatever his faults, was willing to make use of it.
So was Shapley.
I mean, they weren't paragons, but they were in many ways better than other men of their era in terms of giving women.
We'll point out something else on the contribution standpoint. Let me take a second. But Payne also was a mentor of one of the leaders of the gay rights in 1943. The name of the individual escapes me right now, but his writings, she supported and mentored him for several years on that, which was the first step in that direction in society. So they didn't just focus on one thing only.
Well, of course not. Okay. Cultured women.
Is it significant? I mean, were any of these four women married at any point?
Yeah, Grashkin and so was...
Payne was...
So was Cannon.
No, Cannon never married, Levitt never married, okay. And Caroline Herschel never married. Right. Only Payne married, Payne had three children.
But the fact that it was 11, Nittley, 98?
No, it was Herschel.
Okay. I mean, how many people get to do that, you know?
Well, in the 1800s.
I think it's almost more remarkable that out of the ones we covered, Levitt, Cannon, and Herschel were all what we might think of today as handicapped.
Right.
For sure.
Thank you very much.
Let's thank them again. Tavern down on 13 Mile on Woodward for gastronomy and the astronomy. And hopefully we'll see you there. Otherwise, we'll see you next time. Thank you for coming up and have a safe travel.
Finish my talk. Oh, we do.